Yes, welcome back, dear students. Today we are going to understand the remaining output devices of the embedded system, that is piezo buzzer, and after this we are going to understand the push button and the keypad, and lastly, you're going to understand the programmable interface device 8255. These are the things that we're going to discuss in the today's session. Previous class, we understood the input sensors used in the embedded system, and then we started discussing the output devices of the embedded system again. In the last session, we understood the light emitting diode, and after that, the seven segment display. Light emitting diode, I told it has two terminals. One is the cathode terminal, and another one is anode terminal. Now, anode terminal is the longer terminal, and cathode terminal is the shorter terminal. You can distinguish the anode and cathode terminal of light emitting diode by using the length. The longer one is the anode terminal, and the shorter one is the cathode terminal. And if the anode terminal is directly connected to the port pin, if you apply the logic 1, the LED glows. Instead of connecting the anode pin directly to the port pin, if you are connecting the cathode terminal to the port pin, if you apply 0, then if you apply 0 to the port pin, then the LED will glow. And if you apply 1, the LED goes off. This is if you're connecting the cathode directly to the port pin. And similarly, if you connect anode directly to the port pin, if you apply 1, LED glows. If you apply 0, LED goes off. And after that, you understood seven segment display. It's called seven segment display, but strictly speaking, there are eight LEDs inside it. And you know the how these eight LEDs are organized. It's in a circular fashion. If I just go back and show you. So they're organized like this: A, B, C, D, E, F in a clockwise direction, E, F, and this is middle one is G, and this is DP, decimal point, or sometimes you can also call it as H. And then two configurations of this: common anode configuration and common cathode configuration. So in common anode, you have all the anodes connected together. In common cathode, you have all the cathodes connected together. Now in this, if I want to make in common anode configuration, if I want to make any of the LEDs to glow, then I have to give the logic 1. And if I want to make all of them to glow, I have to give 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 everywhere here. 8 ones I have to supply. And similarly, in common cathode, if I want to make any of the LED to glow, I have to apply a logic 0. So this is what we understood. And then we understood optocoupler, which is basically used to separate two circuits. Why this is required? Just to reduce the interference between the two circuits. So this is used in between those two circuits just to reduce the signal interference, or isolate two circuits from one another. And then stepper motor we understood. And here in the stepper motor, I have added this to the previous slide. Now, if how to energize, these are the four poles A, B, C, D. Now, if I want to energize opposite poles here to energize. Now, if I'm energizing A, B, C, you should turn as the opposite pole. A and C are energized because you can see logic 1 is given. These two are energized. Since the windings on these poles are in the opposite direction, if this is acting as north, this will be acting as south pole. If this is acting as south, this will be acting as north. So it is the logic 1 which you are applying for both the poles, but so they if one is north, other one will be acting as south, and accordingly you have the rotor rotating. This I explained how it rotates in the previous class. And after that, you should go for energizing the other two poles B and D. to energize B and D, 1 you have to give, and A and C will be 0. And again, when you energize B and D, if this is acting as B is acting as north pole, the other one will be acting as south pole. If this is acting as north, then this will be acting as south. But again, why? The reason is because the windings on the poles are in the opposite direction. All this we understood. Step angle you understood. Relay you understood. And this is one more thing which I've added. This is schematic diagram of the relay. Now the real relay looks like this. See, this is the coil which is winded. Now when you supply the voltage to this, this acts as a magnet, correct? And this gets, this will come in contact with this, and there is the switch closed. So this is how it operates. When you cut off the voltage supply to this, this is not acting as a magnet, and immediately it will this current contact will be released. And here is one more example. This is what the relay. This is the coil. When you supply the voltage to this, this is the open switch. When you supply the voltage to this, this acts as a magnet, and we have this switch closed, and the bulb here will glow. And similarly, when I cut off the supply to this, this is not acting as a magnet, correct? And again, we have the switch going back to the open state. Now we have to discuss from here for the today's session. Now what we are discussing first is the piezo buzzer. It is again an electronic device which is used as an output device in the embedded system. Now what this piezo buzzer does, as the name itself indicates, it emits an audible sound. And this piezo buzzer as a diaphragm, correct? When you apply the voltage to this piezo buffer, piezo buzzer, it emits an audible sound. And again, the piezoelectric buzzers are available in two types. One is self-driving, another one is external driving. Self-driving piezo buzzer and external driving piezo buzzer. Now, what is self-driving piezo buzzer? The self-driving piezo buzzer has the necessary components inside it in order to produce a predefined tone. All the necessary components it has inside itself in order to emit a predefined tone. When I say external piezo buzzer supports the external different generation of different tones, not one single predefined tone, so it can emit many different types of tones. That is an external piezo buzzer. When you're using you have to use the other external components also. And the majority of the time the piezo buffer buzzer can be directly interfaced with the port pin, and sometimes the piezo buzzer is also interfaced to the port pin by using the transistor. So that is the simple thing, and this is the image what you are seeing, the buzzer, correct? And this you'll find in majority of the embedded system, correct? And again, it is used as an output device just to give the indications to the end users. So, and the next thing that we are going to discuss is the push button switch. So push button switch, again, it is used as an input device. So say when I want to close the circuit or similarly open the circuit, we can go for using the push button switch. And again, the push button switch is available in two configurations. One is a push to make switch and a push to break switch. Now, what is push to make switches? In the push to make configuration, the switch will be initially in open state, and whenever you push the switch, it will take the switch to the closed state, closed circuit or closed state. So that is what is push to make. You are pushing the button in order to make the circuit. And similarly, the other configuration that is available is push to break. Now in push to break configuration, push button switch, the switch will be initially in the closed state, and whenever you push the button, now the circuit will be released. the circuit will go to the open state or the circuit breaks. So these are the two configurations of push button switch. Push button stays in the closed for push to make type, or open for push to break type state. Now, and again, where we use this push buttons? Push buttons are normally used as the reset button, and sometimes it is also used as the start button, and sometimes it is also used for generating the pulses. Now, every time you keep pressing the push button, there is a pulse generated. Now, these are the three major applications of the push button. If you want to reset the circuit, then you can use a push button. For building the start button, you can use the push button, and again to generate the pulses, you can go for using the push button. Every time you press the push button, there is a clock pulse generated. And depending on the way in which the push buttons are interfaced to the controller, it can generate high pulse and low pulse. It depends on how the push button is connected to the controller or the processor. So we'll see that in the next slide here. Now, when I say high pulse or low pulse, so here you, there are two schematics shown here. Now, this is low pulse generator. This schematic is the low pulse generator. You can see here, the switch is here connected towards the terminal that is connected to the ground. Now, in this, if the push button is a low pulse generator, it is like this. The switch is connected towards the ground. Now, when I press this switch, the circuit is closed. And since this is the low resistor path, what goes to the port pin is a low pulse. What goes to the port is the low pulse. And similarly, if you observe this, you have the switch connected towards the VCC, and this is the low resistance path, and here it is, this is the high resistance path. When I push this switch here, now what goes to the port pin is an high pulse, because the pulse takes this path, because it always chooses the low pulse path than compared to the low resistance path than compared to the high resistance path. So in this case, this is the low resistance path, hence zero goes to the port pin, and this is the high resistance path. Now, based on how the push button is connected to the port pin, so there can be two pulses. One is low pulse or high pulse. So this is a low pulse generator, but as this is an high pulse generator. Why this generates an high pulse? Because this is the low resistance path, and this is the high resistance path. Whenever you press this button, what goes to the port pin is an high pulse. And similarly, this is a low pulse generator. Why this is low pulse generator? Because there are two paths. This is one path and this is another path, and this path is a low resistance path than compared to this. When you close the switch, what goes to the port pin is a low pulse. And this is the picture of a push button. This is how it looks. Now, when you press this, the circuit gets closed, and when you release this, the circuit is an open state. And again, it depends. You have two types of switches. One is a push to make switch, and another one is push to break switch. So next important device is the keyboard. Now, this push button is an input device again, and whereas this buzzer is an output device that we understood. Now, keyboard is again an input device. Now, high pulse generated for user interfacing. Now, this keyboard you have seen, the laptop keyboards or the desktop keyboards, and even the cell phone keypads, all these things. Now, when we have this push buttons, why do we need the keyboard? Now, generally, the controllers or the microprocessor will have limited number of ports. Now, if I want to connect too many switches, too many switches or the push buttons, it is not possible. So if the number of keys required is very limited, then you can go for using the push button switches. If the number of switches required is more, then I cannot go for using the push button switches, then I have to go for using the keypad. So larger number of keys for user input, then I have to go for using a keypad. Now how why keypad is the best solution? So because now say for example I need 16, I need to connect 16 switches to my controller or processor. Now then I have to have 16 pins or port pins or 16 port pins in processor or controller. Now if I have only 8 available port pins in my processor or controller, then it is not possible. Say I have 8 port pins available in my processor or controller, but I need to connect 16 push buttons. How do I connect? It is not at all possible. In that case, you can go for using a keypad. Now, matrix keyboard is the optimum solution for handling the large key requirement because it greatly reduces the number of interface connections required. Now, 16, say for example, I need 16 buttons and my processor or controller has only 8 pins available, then the best option for me to use the matrix keyboard. Now, I have the example here. So I want to interface 16 keys to my microprocessor or controller, then I can go for arranging the keys like this as 4 columns and 4 row matrix. So you can see here 4 columns and 4 row matrix, totally I have 16 keys here. Now when I am connecting to the microprocessor or microcontroller, I don't require 16 pins at the microcontroller or the microprocessor, so I need only 8. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 8 pins if I have at the microcontroller or the processor, that is sufficient. Or 8 ports if are available at microcontroller or microprocessor, that is sufficient. Because when I organize them in the form of a matrix, I have 4 rows and 4 columns. Now, and I can connect these 4 rows and 4 columns to the processor or the microcontroller now using 8 ports. I don't require 16 ports. Now with the keypad you can go for reducing the number of ports that are required in order to interface the 16 switches to the processor or the controller. Now here I've interfaced 16 switches, so 4 plus 4, 16 switches to the microprocessor or the microcontroller using only 8 ports. Now that was the schematic diagram, and this is the real 4 cross 4 matrix keypad. You can see here. Now using this keypad, I can key in the numbers from 0 to 9, along with that the star, hash, and A, B, C, D. So this is the schematic diagram of the 4 into 4 keypad, 4 by 4 matrix keypad. Now how say for example now here now when I press this button, the system or the software which you're using must detect now where I have pressed. Now if I press this, I pressed the button which is in row 1 and column 1. Similarly, if I press this button, so this is located at row 2 and column 2. If I press this, this is in column 1 and row 2. Now this is one, when I press this button which is available in what I have to do is I have to go for detecting which row, which column it is. Now if it is in row 1 and column 1, now I'll be interpreting it as digit 1. I have pressed 1. And similarly, if I press this, this is in column 2 and row 3. This is column 2 and row 3. So this will be interpreted as 8. Now, so there is nothing assigned as 8 to this particular button. So this is just a button. Now how we're going to interpret this as 8 based on which column and row it is present. Now how we are going to do this, that is what we are going to understand now. Now here We have all columns connected to the port and all rows connected to the port. What we do is initially we make all columns as I. So the all columns are connected here. See, this is not a junction. Only when I press this, so this forms a junction. Here I have all columns connected to plus VCC. Let me go to the other one. Yeah. Now all columns connected to plus VCC. Plus VCC. So that means initially I'll make this column 0, column 1, column 2 and column 3 as I, logic I. That is, this is 1, 1, 1 and 1. Now if I press, if I say for example, I press this button, I press this button. Now sorry, all columns are connected to logic I and all rows are connected to logic 0. So this is 0, 0, 0, 0 and this is 1, 1, 1, 1. Now if I press this button, now what will happen is, since this row is connected to logic 0 or ground, if I press this button, so the corresponding column will go low. Now initially it was I, the value here was 1, 1, 1, 1 and all rows are connected to ground 0, 0, 0, 0. If assume I press this switch, press this switch, initially this column value, when I read, it was 1. Now after pressing this, it will pull down to 0. Now it is 1, 0, 1, 1. Now I have to examine this column values. Now when I examine, if any of the column value is 0, it means that I have pressed some key in that particular column. Now I have pressed this. Now but how do I make my software understand that I have pressed here only? Now one thing I understood now, since this column value goes 0, I know that I have pressed some key in column 1. But how to identify in which row I have pressed? Whether this is column 1, I have pressed some switch, whether it is this switch, this switch, this switch or this switch. How do I understand this? So that I can understand by applying logic 1 to row 1, row 0 first. Now, that I'll explain because I have with the detailed explanation. Now let me finish. Now logic, I'll apply logic 1 to row 1. Now when I apply logic 1 to row 1, so this particular line goes I. So this is 1, this is still in 0, this is still in 0, this is still in 0. When this goes I, since this is the button which I have pressed, so this will not change from 0 to 1. This will still remain 0. Now next I apply logic 1 to this row. This is again made as 0 and this is made as 1. This is still in 0, this is still in 0. Now this is what I have made as 1. So since I have pressed this button, so now this will pull this column again from 0 to 1. Now the column here, initially I understood, so this is the column where I pressed this switch. Now to know in which row I have pressed, now when I make this particular row as I, so this will again change from 0 to 1. Now I understood, now every time I make a row high, I'll be examining this particular column. Now when I make this row high, so this column will change from 0 to 1. Now it has understood, so the button, the switch which I pressed is at column 2, column 1 and row 1, because here it is starting from row 0 and column 0. So I pressed a switch which is at column 1 and row 1. So this is what it is, and this is column 0 and row 1. So this particular switch is located at column 1 and row 1. So I understood, this is the button which is pressed. This is what the software will do. This is just an ordinary keypad. So that is what is written here. For detecting a key press, the keyboard uses scanning technique. That is what I told. Initially, we make all columns as I. And whenever I press, say for example, here I pressed a switch. So this column will go 0. Now which column is going 0? So 0th column, 1st column and 2nd column. This is going 0. Now, and it's sure I have pressed something in column 2. Now, how do I identify in which row I have pressed? Which row of column 2 I have pressed? Now, what is that I have to do? I have to perform the scanning of all the rows by pulling each row to high at once. So first I'll make this row high. If I pressed a switch in this row, the corresponding column will become high. Now, and if I have to repeat this. I have to repeat this until the corresponding value column becomes high. And the same thing is explained very clearly here. Yeah. So this is the wiring diagram. So just look into this diagram first. So this is what the initial state will be. See, all these are the columns C1, C2, C3, C4, and these are the rows R1, R2, R3, R4. These are connected to the port pins of the microprocessor or the microcontroller, and again we have these are also connected to port pins of the microprocessor or the microcontroller. Now what we are doing here is we are making C1, C2, C3, C4, correct, no, as I. The columns are made I initially. Now, and that is shown in red color. Red color indicates they are I. Columns are I. This is I, this is I, this is I, this is I, and this, correct, no, it's a push button. And right now, correct, no, there is no connection between this and this. There is no connection between columns and rows, correct, no? So columns are separate and rows are separate. So the junction is not formed. Junction will be formed only when you press this button. Now, and all rows are connected to logic zeros. You can see here, I've written here. This is 0, 0. Black color is 0. Black color is 0. This is the initial wiring diagram. Now, and you can observe here, columns are also are made I, and that is represented here in red color again. So this is 1, 1, 1. Initially, this is the state. Now, let us assume I want to press this button. I want to press this button. Let's assume I'm going to press this button. Now I have highlighted this and the green color. Now the initial status, these are all zeros and these are all ones. Now we'll see what happens when I press this button. Now when I press this button, correct, no? So this initially it was I. Now when I press this button, it will come in contact with the row R2, and what is it? Logic 0. Now this C2 will be pulled down to 0. This is what I get, 1 0 1 1. So now the value 0 in C2 indicates that the key pressed is in column 2. Now just the whichever column goes 0, it indicates that. So you have pressed some key in.